Good morning and welcome to Anchor Church. To those of you joining us online, welcome. The kids have been working really hard at practicing to lead us in worship this morning, so won't you please join us and stand and worship with us.
We worship the God who was.
Did a great job. Let's give them a round of applause. Good job, boys and girls. All right, your teachers are going to take you guys back to your room, and you guys go ahead and greet one another.
It's time to check into church. Reach over to your left and grab the guest book. Grab it, fill it out, then pass it down the row so we have a record of your visit and we can stay in touch with you. Well, this is like the biggest weekend in church life coming up. So Friday, be here 7 o'clock to remember the Lord's death on the cross for us. Then it's Easter Sunday. It is the best week of the entire year to invite people to church. Friends, family, neighbors, our theme this year is joy that lasts. Find people who are lacking joy. They're all over the place. Invite them to church Easter Sunday, 9 or 11. And if this is your church home, get here in person. If you're sick, stay home. But if you are healthy and you are in town, Easter is better here on site. So next weekend, Easter Sunday, be here.
Anchor Men, April 6th, 8:30 a.m., Men's Prayer Breakfast. Biscuits and gravy, don't miss it.
Anchor Church, are you married or engaged to be married? If so, we'd love for you to attend our Date Night and Marriage Conference. We will start the evening off with a lovely dinner with your church family and spouse or fiance, followed by biblical teaching from Francis and Lisa Chan, You and Me Forever. We will address the question, what is marriage like in the light of eternity? We will learn how to better know that marriage was designed for God's purpose and learn how to make decisions in light of who the Lord is. Join us on April 20th. Register today.
Well, hey, good morning, Anchor. How's everyone feeling today? Hello. It's Easter week. I'm fired up. Are you fired up? It is Easter week. Amen. And I've got an awesome surprise for you. We are interviewing today a candidate for our worship pastor position, Ryan Jackson. Let's bring him up. Ryan, come on up. Ryan's been here a few times already leading worship. His wife, Savannah, is out there somewhere. Where's Savannah? Wave to us. Savannah, there she is. And we're thrilled to have you guys here. We've been getting to know each other behind the scenes, kind of. When people first come out and they're interested in the position, we don't throw them in front of the lights, you know, so that all of you can judge them, okay? That's not the way we do it. We just let them kind of live it, get to know us for a while. But now it's official. He's applying for the position, and so this is our chance to get to know him and them a bit better. So welcome, Ryan. We're glad you're here.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I've enjoyed the time that I've been able to be with you guys so far, and looking forward to it.
Yeah, so we just want to get to know you. Why don't you tell us where you grew up?
Yeah, so I grew up in the panhandle of Florida. If you know where Pensacola is, it's kind of in that area. So, and I lived in the South my entire life, so the past 2 years living in the Chicagoland area has been a shock to my system, especially this time of year. So, yeah.
And these have been the mild winters, you know what I'm
talking
about?
That's what I keep hearing, and I'm like, what are you talking about?
Yeah. So where'd you go to school? College.
Went to school at University of Mobile, studied worship leadership there. Yeah. Yep.
Awesome. And so getting into worship leadership, how did God do that?
Yeah, so it was interesting. Like, a lot of people that I went to school with, they had been doing music like their whole life. Like, that was kind of their story. But my story was different. I didn't get into music until I was like 19. I'm 34 now. So I picked up guitar around 19. And then I just like started randomly getting asked to lead worship. Like on a mission trip I went to, the guy who was leading it, he was a mentor of mine. He was like, hey, you're going to lead worship tonight. And I was like, no, I'm not. I'm actually not going to do that because I actually don't enjoy being in front of people, oddly enough. So I did it. And then I just felt the Lord just kind of like pushing me in that direction. Yeah. And I dug my heels in for a while. And then eventually just surrendered to that calling, and yeah.
That's great, great. Amen. Yeah, so then you were at a church down there for how many years?
Yeah, in Mobile, Alabama, I was at a church for 7 years, full time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and got married, and then when did you come up to Chicago?
Yeah, so we got married October of 22, right?
Right.
It's so bad.
It's all right. It's the funny, stage lights.
I've seen that happen to other people, and I'm like, that's not good. And that just happened to me. So we're coming up on 2 years married. Yeah. So we started dating. We reconnected because she was studying mental health counseling, and I was interested in that. Yeah. And so we went and got coffee, and I was like, I really like this girl. And then like 2 days into that, she was like, hey, by the way, I have a job offer in Chicago. And I was like, huh? Like, I don't know if that's going to work out. Yeah. But anyway, yeah, so we, and I also felt the Lord kind of leading me in that direction as well. And so we moved up here in October of 22, and I've been here ever since.
And you were leading worship up here where?
Yeah, I was at Harvest Bible Chapel, the Crystal Lake campus, for a year. Yeah.
Awesome. Mm-hmm. And then you want to go back to school because, you're discovering this passion to get into mental health and counseling. And how did you follow that?
Yeah, so in my job in Alabama, like, I started to notice that I really loved walking with people through hard stuff. And so I just started asking God, like, what is this about? And I felt like he was leading me into counseling. And so I am a full-time grad student at Wheaton College currently studying clinical mental health counseling. Mm-hmm. So I'm about halfway through that program. And looking forward to what the future holds there.
Yeah,
for sure.
Well, what we've loved is you've gotten to meet a lot of people behind the scenes is first and foremost, your love for the Lord and your love for people, your shepherd's heart. That's huge. A worship pastor is first a pastor. And you know, having the skill which you do as a worship leader is essential, but really ministry is so much bigger than that. So we've loved so far that you just have a heart for people. You love to share the stage. This is not a spotlight, you even said, you know, it's not like I love being in front of people. And I think that's just what we've kind of come to love about you so far. And so we're glad you guys are here. I'm sure it's a little like in the fishbowl, everybody's looking at you, but we're just really happy you're here. We want you to feel at ease. And after the service, they're going to be in the gym, so you could stop by, get to know them, and encourage them a little bit. But thanks so much. Let's just encourage both of them and thank them for being here today. So Ryan's going to be leading our Easter service next week as his official candidacy service. So it's going to be a great week next week, and it'll be one more chance to get to know them. All right, well, we have a few more announcements, and the ushers are going to come forward to take up our offering this morning. If you are a guest with us today in person, we would love for you to stop by the welcome table in the lobby after the service. We have a gift for you as our way of saying welcome to Anchor Church. If you are online, we are thrilled that you are online. Welcome. We really want everybody to get here in person next week for Easter. And hey, let's dress up a little. What do you think? Should we look nice? Yeah? What do you think? I'm gonna dress up. It's gonna be great. And so we want you, if you're healthy and you're in town, be here in person, and we want you to bring a friend. Now, how many of you this week have passed out invitations to the Easter service in your neighborhood, or you came to church to pass out invitations? Raise up your hand if you've done that already. All right, now look around. Everybody look around. It's time to do better than this. Amen? Amen. Let's just for a moment here pretend. Everybody put your hand up. Wouldn't that be awesome? Now put your hand down. I want to see that next week. On the way out, you're going to get invites. If you want a different world, a better world, a world where more people are governed by the love of Christ, you have to get out there and you have to do the hard work of inviting your neighbors. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So I want you to not sit back and watch other people do it. I want you to take the invitations to your street today. Tonight at 5 p.m., tomorrow at 5 p.m., I want you here. I want you to get here either today or tomorrow, and I want you to say, give me a stack. I'm going to go invite people to hear the gospel. Amen?
Amen?
Come tonight. Come tomorrow night. Grab the invites on the way out, and we are going to be a culture of invitation because we desperately want people to be impacted by the gospel of Jesus Christ, right?
Right?
Right? And it starts with a simple invitation to come and hear the great news. So let's get out there tonight. What time? Tomorrow, what time? Be here. All right, we are going to take up our offering right now. We'd love for you to give, and there's several ways you can, online, through the app, in person, or through mail. We'd love for you to prepare your offering and your heart right now, because giving really is a matter of the heart. Jesus wants to feel loved and worshiped and adored, so God loves a cheerful giver. So prepare your heart as we pray right now for this morning's offering. Let's pray. Jesus, we love you, and we want the world to love you. We want everyone to hear the great news, the greatest news that has ever been told. He is risen. The world needs to hear it. Send us out. Here we are. Send us. Oh Lord, give us divine appointments this week for people who need to hear the gospel. Give us a heart for the lost. We pray for those in the community all around us right now, those who don't have the knowledge of the glory of Christ. Get them here next week. Impact them with your love. Show them your glory. We want to be used by you, O Lord, and we want hearts to be changed forever and ever. We pray this in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Amen. The series we're in right now is called The Emotionally Healthy Church, and we've covered a bunch of emotions already. In fact, we've got the list here of all the different emotions that we're going through in this series, The Emotionally Healthy Church. We've done 2 weeks on shame, two on pride, then we did envy. Fear is today, then anger, sorrow, greed, boredom, lust. Joy is next week, and then the greatest is love. And so today is anxiety. Anxiety. We've got a slide there with when we fret and fear, and the other emotions we've covered already are in the upper left, because we want to make sure that those are sermons that we remember about shame and about pride and about envy. But today, the sermon is about anxiety, when we fret and when we fear. I was going to preach from the Bible, but then I went on Amazon and I found something that is a game changer. I found the Worst Case Scenario Survival Handbook, Apocalypse Edition. And so this has everything we need to never worry again. So what I'm going to do is just read from this book all morning long. The Worst Case Scenario. Once I get through it, you're never going to have any more worries. We're going to cover prepping, how not to panic when you think the world is about to end, how to get your bunker ready, how to make your bunker feel like home. That's point one. Then we're going to go into apocalyptic events, how to survive an alien invasion, a zombie horde, how to defeat a global AI supercomputer, and then a robot uprising. And then we're going to get into dangerous creatures, how to fend off a pack of wolves, how to befriend a gorilla, how to escape clone dinosaurs, and finally, how to rebuild a utopian society. Get your pens out. When I get done reading this book, you're not going to have anything else to worry about. Well, of course I'm not reading that. We're going to talk about anxiety today, which is narrowing the topic of fear, when we fret and when we fear. We all want to get ready for the worst case scenarios. We all face anxiety and battle it at different levels. For some of us, this is the big one. And I want to be honest with you this morning. This is my big weakness. This is the one I've battled my whole life. You might not know it because I don't go around talking about it, but deep within, this has been a stronghold in my soul forever. In fact, I was praying this week, like, Lord, I shouldn't even be preaching this sermon. Somebody else should be preaching this sermon because this is not an area of strength for me. I listened to a bunch of sermons this week to sit under other godly preachers as a way to humble myself and say, Lord, I want to hear from you and really speak from a place where I'm being transformed. I need to give a lot of credit to Alistair Begg. Do you know Alistair Begg? One of his sermons from this very passage we're covering today changed my life. And I drew a lot of my inspiration for this sermon from his sermon. And so I'm giving credit where credit is due. His sermon deeply impacted me. I loved in his sermon how he also said that he's battled anxiety his whole life. His mother died when he was in college. The president of the university showed up and told him his mother just passed away. He said, from that point on, it was a lifelong battle. What am I going to do? What's my family going to do? What's this? What's that? And so he spoke out of that place of feeling like this was a strong weakness in his life. Well, maybe this is yours too. We're going to talk about when we fret and when we fear. Here's one more slide with a bit of an expanded definition. Anxiety in particular is when we doubt God's power and presence while his perfect plan unfolds. When we doubt God's power and presence while his perfect plan unfolds. Let's pray, and then we'll get into the Bible together. Father, we ask you to teach us to enjoy the peace that surpasses all understanding. This peace is impossible, Jesus, apart from you, because you are the Prince of Peace. Oh, Lord, we know that if we come to you, we can have an enduring calm no matter what storms are raging around us. Great peace have those who love you, love your law, follow you, trust you. You keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts you. Trust in the Lord forever. For the Lord God is an everlasting rock. Lord, we know these things. Help us to abide in them. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to 1 Peter 5. 1 Peter 5. Peter has been called the disciple with the foot-shaped mouth. And he wrote an epistle. He has now, later in his life, a love for the church. So as you turn to 1 Peter 5, you're going to a shepherd. And Peter wants his people to feel loved. He's writing to many Christians in many areas of the first century, and they have big problems. And he's trying to help them see that they have big problems. God's allowed them into their lives. They're not going to last forever. While they wait to see how things pan out, they should not be anxious. So God is shepherding you and me today. He wants us to know that we are going to have problems, and he wants us to know exactly how to cope when those problems come our way. So in 1 Peter 5, we only have two verses today. That's where we're going to be. 1 Peter 5, 6 to 7. Here's what it says. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time, he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. The first thing we're going to do is drill down on the word that's used here. So number one, you can write this down. What is anxiety and why do we battle it? What is this? He says here, cast all of your cares, right? Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. What is anxiety? It starts with routine concerns throughout the day that continue to get elevated, like a boiling pot. You have problems, you have burdens, and they start to get heavier, they start to get harder. Then it keeps welling up, and it becomes what the Bible would call anxiety. When it comes to anxiety, we all face it. Peter's audience faced it. They had big problems. They had families, they had children, they had no health care. They were under the rule of Rome. They had little freedom compared to us. So they had big problems. They were also this little niche group called Christians. And to become a Christian meant to pretty much lose your connections with your primary group. Your family would disown you. Sometimes they lost property. They did not have minor problems. Just like you and me, they had really big problems and often bigger problems than us. So Peter's writing to them to shepherd them. What do we fear most today? Well, Jerry Seinfeld is famous for saying that death is actually the number two fear that people have. People's greatest fear is public speaking. Welcome to my life. So Jerry Seinfeld said that people would therefore rather be in the casket than giving the eulogy. Think about it. What do we fear? Spiders, darkness. Some fear being alone, some fear being in a crowd. Conflict, tests at school, getting caught doing something wrong, a medical crisis, money problems, inflation, car accidents, taxes. What do you fear? Elections. What do you fear? We all have fears, but at the deepest level, our primary core fears would be for social rejection, failure, the future in general, and the greatest of all, death. That's why fear lurks deep down in the soul of every person in this room. That's why these verses are necessary for all of us, because we all have fears. So that's anxiety, and that's why we battle it. That's why everyone has battled it throughout the ages, including Peter and his audience and you and me today. Write this down. What does the word mean? The word means to divide or distract within. The word there for anxiety means to divide or distract within. The picture is of being drawn in two directions at the same time. It can closely be tied, therefore, to double-minded, being double-minded. It's a civil war that breaks out within you. That's what creates the clamor, consumes your mind, and consumes your heart. Part of you and part of the situation feels like it will end well. But part of you and part of the situation feels like it's going to end very, very badly. That's where the tension of anxiety comes from. You can't see where it's going to go. That division creates a distraction and can pull us away. This is where it goes into sin, can pull us away from what we know to be true about God. That's how it works. So anxiety takes place while you wait to see how things will unfold or end. Nobody's anxious when they watch a Super Bowl that you already know how it's going to end. There's no anxiety if you know the ending. If you've already seen the movie, there's no anxiety. There might be excitement, but you're not worried because you know how it's going to end. So while you wait to see how things will unfold or end, you are torn into turmoil, you feel distress, and you're distracted, and you are tempted to doubt God. That's the whole mixture of anxiety. Now, this is a common experience for everyone. And Jesus was so gentle when he said, "Martha, Martha, you are worried about many things, but only one is required. Mary has chosen the best, and it will not be taken from her." It's a picture of Jesus calming us down, turning us back to what it means to sit at his feet, even when there's a lot to do. Everyone's coming over. Tell her to help me. Is that you? Fill in your name. Your name. Your name. You are worried about many things, but just one is truly necessary. It will not be taken from you if you choose it. This temptation of the turmoil, the distress, the doubt, the distraction to draw us away from trusting God is the temptation of anxiety. So write this down. The result of this experience is we feel unstable, uncertain, and insecure. We feel unstable. We don't know where we're standing. Uncertain. We don't know what's coming. And insecure. We don't know if we can do this. This is what it feels like when anxiety is taking root in our hearts. It's not wrong to have cares. We all do. It's life. The Bible reports plainly that this is life. Paul in several places says, for example, the married man is going to have cares that divide him from all the different things that he needs to be worried about, including Christ. So it's inevitable. It's inescapable. So when you have cares that pile up, a burden or a worry or a problem, that's not wrong. That makes this a little different from emotions like envy or pride or lust, which are sinful from the very moment you go down that road. This is different. It's inevitable that you will have these cares. Paul said, "I have all the cares daily for all the churches." Having them is not the problem. It's what they're driving you to do. That's the crossroads. So the result is we feel unstable, uncertain, and insecure. The weight will either drive us to depend on God or to depend on ourselves. That's the big question. Here's the word family of many of the words used in the Bible for fear. And when it comes to being fearful, there's afraid, dismayed, anxious is our singled out word for today. Quickly shaken in mind, double-minded, fearful, alarmed, panic, dread, terror, faint-hearted, turmoil within, trembling, shudder, shaken, terrified, frightened, cowardly, unsettled, troubled, or distressed. Do you see these in your own soul right now? Anxiety is of the family of fear. I think the best description of anxiety in particular was mentioned by Brené Brown, who's not a Christian, but she writes a lot about mental health. And she said the best description for anxiety that I can tell you is the Willy Wonka and the Charlie and the Chocolate Factory movie when they go into that dark, weird, strange, frightening tunnel. Here's a picture. Do you remember this? How many of you grew up watching this movie? How many of you raise your hand if you remember the tunnel scene? Do you remember the tunnel? It's lollipops and songs and chocolate rivers, and then, oh my goodness, what's happening? Children are watching. Fast forward this. And what does Willy Wonka say? There's no earthly way of knowing which direction we are going. There's no knowing where we're rowing or which way the river's flowing. Is it raining? Is it snowing? Is a hurricane a-blowing? Not a speck of light is showing, so the danger must be growing. Is the fires of hell a-glowing? Is the grisly reaper mowing? Yes, the danger must be growing, for the rowers keep on rowing. Brené Brown says, that's what anxiety feels like to me. Get, period, me, period, off, period, this, period, boat! Exclamation point. If you're feeling that get me off this boat based on what I'm seeing and what I'm hearing and what I'm thinking, that's anxiety. It could drive you ultimately to panic. It could drive you ultimately to frantic behavior. But it starts with a rolling boil, a burning fear that stays there sometimes for decades. So the word means to divide or distract. The result is we feel unstable, uncertain, and insecure. What are you worrying about right now? What is it that you're seeing and hearing that's unsettling you? What is it that is tearing you in two directions? What is it right now that's giving you distress and tempting you to doubt the goodness of your God? Jot this down. The reason that we experience this is because we see missing assurances of God's provision and protection. We see missing assurances of God's provision or protection. Right now, there are problems that you have. There are burdens that you're carrying. Part of you thinks it's going to work out okay. You remember what the Bible says. You know what he's done for you in the past. But then there's another part of you that says, the ship is going down. The reason you could even feel that way in the first place is because God has withheld certain assurances. You can't see them. You don't have them. There's missing pieces. And therefore, there's a gap there. Now, you can fill in that gap with faith. Can't see it now, but I believe. Or with fear. Oh my goodness, what is going to happen next? What is going to happen at the next doctor's appointment? What is going to happen at the next annual review? What is going to happen at the next budget talk? I can't see it. You have missing assurances. And therefore, there's reason to wonder if God will provide or protect. Therefore, you must walk by faith or become double-minded in doubt. What missing assurances do you have? I would invite you this week, I do this, to write down the missing assurances you have, the things you can't see, the things you don't know. And then in the background, draw a big old mountain and start writing out the assurances that God has already given you in Christ, the promises he's made to you, the trophies that are in your case, the way that he's come through for you. If you focus on the mountain of assurances you already have, you won't doubt in the foreground the things that are missing. But if your eyes are glued to the foreground, you're not going to see the mountain. And here's the truth. When there are missing assurances of God's provision or protection, he has never, never once, never even one time given us justifiable reason to doubt him. There's never a reason to fear he's going to come through. Do you realize the stakes? If God gets one problem in your life truly wrong, Satan wins. Do you realize that? Do you realize that God has to get it perfect? He has to pitch a perfect game from the Alpha to the Omega. If he really does drop the ball with you, Satan wins, and there goes the cosmos. We can trust him because he's already promised to work it together for good. Tim Keller said this, "Worry is not believing God will get it right. And bitterness is believing God got it wrong." So this is the word. What is anxiety? Why do we battle it? It means to divide or distract. The result is we feel unstable, uncertain, and insecure. The reason is we see missing assurances of God's provision and protection. All that comes from the word and how we experience this in life. Number two, write this down. There are principles of anxiety found in this passage. The principles of anxiety found in this passage, we're going to pull three of them. But it says here in verse 6, humble yourselves. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time, he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. In some translations, like the NIV, there's a break there. So verse 7 will say, cast all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. It's actually a participle there, which means it's supposed to be a run-on sentence. Here's why it matters. If the two sentences aren't connected, you won't start with humility. You'll miss it. And you'll go right to, I need to cast all my cares upon him. I cast all my cares upon you. I lay all of my burdens down at your feet. At any time, I don't know what to do. I cast all my cares upon you. Good. Back the truck up one verse. And what does it say first? Say it with me. Humble yourselves. That's where it begins. So, for principles of anxiety, which is number two, you can write that down if you didn't already, principles of anxiety, there are really two roads to walk. You can put this up, this picture up there. Two roads, your choice. Two ways to handle problems. Problem minus God plus fear equals worry. That's the bad road. Problem plus God minus fear equals worship. Fundamentally, this is your choice. Every day, every moment, you're either going to pick problem minus God plus fear equals worry, or problem plus God minus fear equals worship. Those are your two fundamental choices. So write this down. The presence of anxiety springs from the absence of humility. This I took straight from Alistair Begg. This is quoting him. The presence of anxiety springs from the absence of humility. If we don't understand this, we're never going to get the peace of God. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so at the proper time he may exalt you. The imperative, the decision, the command to humble yourself when trials come, when daily needs pile up, the need to get low under the mighty hand of God is something that we never want to do. We don't want to get lower, we want to get higher. We don't want to be brought smaller, we want to get bigger. So the hand of God upon us, pushing us lower, we will inherently resist. We don't like trials. And Peter talks about in the early chapters what it's like in chapter 1, verse 6, "In this you rejoice, though for now you have for a little while, if necessary, been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ." That's why your life is on fire right now. That's why, to grow your faith. So the presence of anxiety springs from the absence of humility. God will allow problems too big, burdens too heavy to humble you. And the root of the word means to be brought as close to the ground as possible. You and carpet. That's why these burdens have come into your life, to teach you humility. If there is the persistence of anxiety, the worrying, the trying to figure it out, the determination to get rid of these problems, the resistance to feeling unsettled, that's an absence of humility. Nobody likes to get low, so we fight it. Therefore, we can't separate our endless worrying and fussing from a posture of protest and a refusal to surrender to God. We have to see that. We are wrestling with God for control of our problems when we won't humble ourselves. It's inherently haughty to not be humble. I love the story Alistair Begg shared in his sermon. He knew he struggled with anxiety his whole life, but he caught himself more and more as he was traveling, travel a lot, getting on the plane. He'd sit down, get there early, he'd sit down, he'd find his seat, and he'd start kind of doing the check with the rest of the crew. He'd listen to the flaps going up and down, he'd watch this and that, and if he noticed something that seemed out of place, he'd contact the flight attendant and ask her if she can check on that. And one day he realized that he would actually get up and maybe even ask the pilot a question, "Did you do this? Did you do that? Did you do this? Did you do that?" And one day he realized, "Who do I think I am? I am not a licensed pilot. I am not a certified mechanic, and I'm going to fly the plane from seat 23C. He said, "I realized how pompous and proud and arrogant this is, to think I could in any way help this process to go better. He's a liability at best." Do you see, as I did, because I was greatly convicted by his story, do you see how proud it is to think you can be flying the plane from 23C? Do you see that it's not your business? You don't have that qualification to reach over? Do you help people drive sometimes? It's a joke in every marriage, isn't it? A little helper in the car. Do you reach over and try and help people drive? Would you like a teacher break? Do you overstep your grounds to try and help other people? I do. Who do you think you are? It's so important to realize the consequences of this, because the verse before this in verse 5, it says, "God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble." Amen. When you think you deserve more control over your problems or other people's problems, you're inviting God's opposition. Now, this is where you got to find your rationalizations. Because there's always rationalization. Oh, you want me to just back off and do nothing? Yeah, then my kids, I'm sure, would turn out fine. My husband can't even find his keys without me. There's rationalizations for why you need to be the little co-pilot in everybody else's life and why God needs to read your comments that you've put in the comment box. If you don't find your rationalizations, the sin will never go away because you really think you're right. And you'll find your greatest fear. "Oh, I've heard doomsday stories of how this is going to end if I don't step in and fly this baby from 23C. Do you see the pride? Do you see the fear? Do you see the outright folly of it all? And do you see that you are inviting God's opposition because he's flying the whole universe. He doesn't need your help. He doesn't need my help. So there's conviction, there's regret when we allow anxiety to get us way overconfident. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all of your anxieties on him because he cares for you. This is a portrait of prayer, so jot this down. The presence of anxiety springs from the lack of prayer, lack of humility and lack of prayer. If you're worrying in a sinful manner, it's because you're not praying in a righteous manner. Humility, Tim Keller said that prayer both requires and produces humility. Prayer both requires and produces humility. Lacking prayer shows also pride, but that's why we worry. The word for casting there means to throw it with force. Casting all of your cares. So I have a teenage son, junior in high school. He gets home Friday with his backpack, and he throws it up against the wall because it's weekend. I can't get him to open that backpack if I paid him $1 million. It is gone until Monday. That's what we do with our problems. We are not to cling to them. We are to get as low as possible and then throw them up as high as we can. We get low, we throw them high. That's prayer. That's what we should do with our worries. But we carry them around endlessly and we wear ourselves out. Philippians 4, 6 to 7 makes it clear, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. How's your prayer life right now? Are you casting all of your cares upon him, or are you carrying them, crushing yourself? We have many ways that we challenge people to grow in prayer. One thing we're doing this year is you can go on Amazon and they sell blank decks of cards, 52 cards. It's like $4. And I challenge people to write 52 prayers, one a week for this year. How many of you are doing that 52 challenge? You got a deck of cards, you're filling it out. And so you could still do this. You can get one of those, write out your big ones, all of your cares, and then give one its week. Like, all right, it's your week, fella. I'm praying about you all week long. Keep cycling through the rest of them. But for that one, just carry it around all week long. This is one way you could improve your prayer life if you need a way. This is a way you can increase your prayers to the Lord. The presence of anxiety springs from the lack of prayer. Jot this down. The presence of anxiety springs from the lack of faith. From the lack of faith. Faith in God's goodness and his power. It says, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Because he cares for you. Where he says, no, he doesn't. He cares for you. No, he doesn't. He's going to come through for you. No, he's not. He will provide. No, the ship is going down. The lies we believe about God is a lack of faith. The presence of anxiety springs from the lack of faith. We have to point out that it's insulting to act as though God isn't the perfect planner who's fathering you well. To treat him as if he's dropping the ball, to treat him as if he's going to get it wrong is insulting. And it's a lack of faith. What did the disciples say when the storm came? Wake up! We're going to die! Jesus got up, he already told them we're going to go to the other side. Gets up, calms the storm, stills the sea. And then what did he say? Where is your faith? Maybe your anxiety is prompting God to ask you that this morning. Where is your faith? Where is your faith? Where, do you think it finally happened? You think this is the one that's going to, this is so big, God's not going to get it right? A problem this size. Do you see that your problems are actually microscopic to an immense God? He has trouble seeing it. It's so small. The tweezers he needs to pick them up are nothing. Your problems are not big to him. It's insulting to lack faith in God's competency. God is, here's a great word for you, omnicompetent. He does all things well. He will never fail you. And his timing is perfect. So years ago, we would do a lot of mission trips to Europe. We've got friends in Romania, friends in Ukraine. So on one trip, I was in charge of planning it. And it was like multi-nations. We went to Ukraine, we went to Romania, then we came back through London, we took a train out to Oxford to visit a partner, then came back and flew home. I was in charge of all of that. Here's a picture of me in London in front of Big Ben. That's me and Big Ben. And so I felt pretty good about the plan I put in place. I was proud of myself. I even bought the travel insurance. But the guy who was with me for all of the trip kept worrying about everything. Everywhere we'd go, he was asking me 20 questions. Did you think of this? Did you think of this? Did you remember this? Are we going to do this? And as time went on, it got really annoying. He was not really trusting me, and so I was getting irritated that he didn't trust that we had a great plan. I was like, I got this. It was even more humorous that while he was worrying about the plans that I already put in place, when we were in London, he kept trying to walk out in the street right in front of a bus because they drive on the wrong side of the street. So usually here, when you get up to a street, you look left and you see if a car is coming, then you start walking. Problem in London is the car's right here. So literally four times, he was like this, about to walk out in front of a bus, and then a motorcycle, and then a car, and then a cyclist. I had to hold him back and say, whoa, you did it again. And I think that's how I make God feel when I'm like, did you think of this? Did you think of this? Did you think of this? He's like, bus! Bus! You worry about the bus. I've got the whole trip planned. And maybe that's you. Maybe you just need to realize this is you while you're fussing about God's plan. And he's like, bus! Let him do the planning. Amen. Let him get your trip under control. And you just listen when he says bus. I'm reminded that only two things amazed Jesus while he was on earth. Do you know what they were? Only two things amazed Jesus when he was on earth. Great faith and great lack of faith. Are his eyebrows going up when he looks at you? And if so, why? Because of your great faith? Or because of your great lack of faith? Number one, what is anxiety and why do we battle it? Number two, principles of anxiety. It springs from the absence of humility, the lack of prayer, and a lack of faith. Number three, jot this down. There's promises that bring lasting peace. I've got great news for you. There's only one thing that will truly give you a peace that lasts forever. Yes, natural steps to battle anxiety will help. Limit your caffeine. Yes. Exercise daily. Yes. Get plenty of sleep. Uh-huh. That won't last. That won't last. Because your car insurance is going up. That won't last. It's only through God's promises in Christ Jesus that you can enjoy a peace that will last forever. And that's the promise that I want to share with you. Only if you have the promises of Jesus Christ will you be able to get rid of anxiety. Look, you can watch Lion King every day for the rest of your life and sing Hakuna Matata. It ain't going to work. The worries are coming. You need the Prince of Peace. So jot this down. God is greater than you. He alone can bear your burdens. God is greater than you. He alone can carry your burdens. It says here in verse 6, the mighty hand of God. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. It's only under the mighty hand of God that you realize he's greater and he can carry your burdens. In verse 10, it says this, and after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, listen, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore. Do you know God has called you to his eternal glory in Christ? In chapter 1, verses 3 to 4, it says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. He did what? He raised Jesus from the dead. to an inheritance, that's ours, that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. He took care of the end of the story. Whatever you're worrying about on the way, the ending is perfect. You know how it's going to end. Did you read those books growing up, Choose Your Own Adventure? Raise your hand if you read those books, Choose Your Own Adventure. Let's put that picture up, Lori. The picture of the books may have been ahead a bit, but I read these. I read all of The Forest of Fear. Ooh. The way it worked is you had a choice to make. If you want to go into the forest, go to page 7. If you want to avoid the forest, go to page 15. Tons of terrible endings. If you go down page 7, you're devoured by a bear. But if you go to page 12, you meet the forest princess and live happily happily ever after. So what you did is you cheated. You kind of looked ahead. You didn't let your friends see it. You got, I need to get to page 34. Okay, page 34. You get there, and then you get there. I did it! You try and brag to all those fools who got killed by the bear. Because you got the happy ending. They didn't. God is greater than you. He alone can carry your burdens, and the biggest burdens you have are sin, death, and Satan. They're the biggest problems in your life. Sin, you can't fix your own depravity. Death, you are going to die. And Satan, he's cloaked. You can't even see him, and he can destroy your life. Biggest problems you got. And at the cross, he defeated all three. Sin, death, and Satan. God is greater than you, and his mighty hand has already secured a place in heaven for you. Trust him. He is greater than you. This is a promise that brings you peace. The moment worry starts, you have to say this to yourself. You have to say, God is greater than me. His mighty hand can carry this. That's where it starts. Jot this down. God is for you. God is for you. He alone can lift you up. It says his mighty hand, so that at the proper time he may exalt you. He may exalt you. He brings you low to bring you back up stronger. He doesn't keep you low. He's already got the highest, highest, highest place in heaven waiting for you, the very throne of Christ. So you are temporarily brought low so that he can exalt you and your faith will be stronger. Therefore, God is for you, not against you. In his time, it's going to take time. He will lift you up. Do you have that hope? If Jesus is your Prince of Peace, you have that hope. And I need you to know this. If you are not a Christian, if you are not saved, you really need to hear me right now. Because if you are a Christian, part of you will wonder, this isn't going to work out. It's going to end terrible. Part of you will feel that way. The part of you that realizes God is good, he promised to take care of me, and he's going to come through, that part is true. The part of you as a Christian that thinks God's going to abandon me, it's not going to end well, that part is false, right? That part is false, right? Now, if you're not a Christian, the part of you that says, it's all going to work out, I'm going to be fine, I'm going to get through this, that part is wrong. That part is actually your destiny. So I meant to say it's right. It is going to end badly. It's not going to work out right. The part of you that says, I'm going to be good is wrong. The part of you that says, this is going to end badly. You know, that part is right. So here's the point. If you have the Prince of Peace, you have the promise of paradise forever. If you're going through this life without Jesus, you don't have hope. Your story is going to end badly. And then you go off to eternal conscious torment forever. I don't know what else you're worried about, but that should be the big one. The big one should be you're living and dying without hope in Jesus Christ. That's what should keep you up at night. God is for you if you have his son. He who has the son has life. He who does not have the son of God does not have life. Write this down. Finally, God is with you. He cares deeply for you. It says in verse 4, when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. I love that. Jesus is the chief shepherd who's got this crown of glory. He's going to appear, show up, and crown you to rule with him. What? That's my ending? That's amazing. I want you to know that you have Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, so that when he appears, you get to go to heaven with him forever. Then you won't be worried about anything for eternity. If you don't have Jesus, you don't have that promise. But you can today. Hey, do you struggle with anxiety? I do. And I hope you hear my messages a lot more than, relax. No, it's more than that. My message is a lot more than regret. Regret that you're having these worries. No, no. Regret, yes. Relax, yes. But rejoice. Rejoice. He's coming back. And it's going to be perfect forever. He's got it all under control. Rejoice. Rejoice. That's the point. If you struggle with anxiety, I have one last story to tell. Once there was a man who lived in a bad neighborhood, so he found a pack of wild wolves and brought them home to make himself more safe. Surely no one would mess with him if he had a pack of wild wolves living in his house. But they chewed up all of his furniture, ate up all of his food, made a huge mess on the floors, and howled all night long. This poor old man never slept, never ate, and grew more and more miserable. One day a lion walked in, looked around, and said, "Would you like me to protect you? Then you can get rid of all these terrible wolves." The man said, "Yes!" He shooed all the wolves out of his house, cleaned up the mess, and then the lion began to leave. And he said, "Where are you going?" He said, "Don't worry, I'm going to watch over your place from above. On the roof, no higher. On the hill, no higher than that. On the mountain, even higher than that." "What's higher than a mountain?" "Trust me, I can see everything from where I'm going." Well, he cleaned up the house, finally sat down to have the first good meal he'd had in a long time, and he slept through the night. And he heard those wolves howling off in the distance, and he was so thankful that he now had a lion higher than the highest mountain watching over the whole world all at once so that he could sleep. That's a parable for you. Your worries are those wild wolves that howl all day long and make a terrible mess in your life, and you think they're making your life safer, but they're making you totally miserable. Why would you even need a pack of wild wolves in your house when you have a lion up in heaven on the throne watching over the whole wide world for you while you sleep? Open the door, shoo them out, and let Christ take care of you. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we invite you to transform us because we all have many cares and worries and anxieties. Lord, forgive us for doubting you. Forgive us for fearing the future, for treating you in an insulting way as if you're not the perfect planner, the perfect pilot, the chief shepherd. Forgive us, O Lord, for when we doubt you. Our problems grow so big and so heavy, we even convince ourselves that not even you can come through for us, or not even you will be there to protect us. What pride, what lack of faith, what folly. Lord, we repent. Help us, O Lord, because these worries have ravaged us. They've stolen our peace. They've robbed us of joy. They've lied to us. O Lord, they've created such a mess. I pray that you would help us, Lord, to repent, to turn away from this destructive road, to bow ourselves low before you, and to hurl all of our cares high up to heaven. That's where they belong, in your throne room. Lord, we can't carry them, we never could. Forgive us for thinking we could fly the plane in seat 23C. Who do we think we are? How foolish and how proud and how haughty. Lord, I pray for those today who came here without the hope of the gospel. They've, their whole lives, been wearing themselves out, worrying about this, worrying about that. Maybe today they realize they've not worried about the main thing, where they're going after they die. They thought they'd be okay, but without Jesus, they have no Prince of Peace. Lord, I pray that they would repent. Repent of their self-determination, repent of their self-reliance, their micromanaging and fussing and freaking out. Lord, I pray that they would repent and say, "Jesus, save me. Be my chief shepherd. Be my Lord. Lift me up. Bring me to heaven. because I believe you died and rose again. Lord, if they pray that in their heart, give them a peace, for the first time, a peace that they don't have to worry. You have everything under control. You will take perfect care of them. Oh God, we cast all of our cares upon you. We lay all of our burdens down at your feet. Forgive us for our anxiety. And I pray that this week you would help us, oh Lord, to know that you are up on high watching over the whole world. And so we have nothing to fear. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Will you stand as we respond to this in worship?
In Christ alone.
Amen. Well, one final joy we have is we are officially inviting a few new members into the congregation today. So I'm going to invite them up right now. You can come on up. But Irma Estrada, John Oswald, and then Josh and Sandra Cruz. Come on up on stage right now. Let's get a little light. Can we get some lights up here? Come on up. Let's give them a round of applause. Come on up on stage. Come on. Come on. There we go. All right. Come on up. We might not have the lights for you, but that's all right. So we're just thrilled that you guys are joining the church. I think you guys already technically joined, but you were sick the first time we announced you guys. But we're thrilled. They went through the steps, and they've gotten to know people. If you go through step one, step two, and then step three is where we hear your testimony of faith, and you officially get welcomed into the church family. So we know that we all need a spiritual community if we're going to grow and thrive. We're thrilled that you guys have said, this is the place. Here we are, and so we're grateful for you all. Why don't you step down on the floor here, and if you are a member here at Anchor, come forward and welcome these new people into membership, and then make sure you stop in the lobby or in the gym and say hi to Ryan Jackson and his wife, Savannah, and don't forget, 5 p.m. tonight or tomorrow, come help us invite people to the church. Hey, you are loved. I'll see you Friday for Good Friday or Easter Sunday. God bless.